We're here with Michael Rubenstone. Michael is the producer, writer, director of a really good. I'm going to be honest with you, man. I got your documentary 2 days ago, and I've watched it three times on the sly in search of the family stone. So I've always in my life, I thought I was the biggest Sly Stone fan. I always have been. I always have thought, you know, and I think you're much younger than I am. I'm in my 50s. So I'll just take the crown for like the biggest Sly Stone fan in his 50s. You could have it for what your 30s are, you know, you can own that crown, man.
Yeah.
But you paid the cost to be the boss of the Sly Stone fans because you devoted years of your life searching for this guy. Mm-hmm. And when I read about your movie, when I read about the documentary that you did on Sly in search of the family stone, I called my producer and I said, I've got to meet this guy because he did what I wanted to do. I wanted to find Sly Stone. And I thought he's going to meet me and he's going to go, oh, you're my biggest fan. Let me tell you about my life and let me tell you about my story. Come into my world. And thank you, Michael, for saving me a whole lot of money.
Dude,
and time.
And I'm happy to do that for you because, I feel you, man. And that was the spirit of the film. It's just like, oh, what happens if we pick up a camera and go look for our lost hero? What happens? I would say Sly Stone is probably one of the most difficult, you know, heroes to go search for. I mean, you go and look for Bruce Springsteen, it would be a different movie.
Right.
He's a very challenging dude, but that's the spirit of the film. It's just like, I'm a fan. I'm a true fan. I'm a fan of music. I'm a huge fan of funk and Sly's music, hit me in a way, that music is, you know, it's one of those moments in your life where you're just like, wow, everything sort of opens up. And it happened at a certain time in my life when he really helped me, you know, his music, his lyrics, you know, sometimes music just hits you at that right time with the right music. And Sly was that for me. I just figured, you know, I was in LA, I was struggling to make my way here, as an actor and filmmaker. And I was just like, you know what if I, you know, go look for this guy. I think he lives right up the street. It'll be easy. You know, I
can right.
knock on his door and who knows? Yeah. Maybe he'll answer, you know, in his underwear eating cereal, you know, and we'll jam. I had no idea. I knew that it would be a challenge. I knew it would be interesting. But I just had no idea what I was in for.
Man, I got to tell you this, that voyage of yours, that's a dark, dark dude. He is a dark guy, man. Everything about your movie, anyone who had any interaction with him, his family, his ex-bandmates, the executives, all of them say the same thing, man. And it's always dark with that guy. It's like, hey, guy, you don't know what you're asking for. You know what I mean? It's not like, oh, yeah, you should try to meet him. He's going to be a little difficult. But, you know, if you get there, he's good. He's a good, you know, you have a good dinner. Take him out for, you know, buy him a drink. No, Everyone was like, dude, don't. You don't know what you're asking for. I felt like I was watching, I know it is a movie, but I felt like I was watching a movie, right? About like a fictional character, like a Kaiser Sose or something.
He is. He's just, you know, it's a very Moby Dick story, you know? Like you're searching for the white whale and you're searching for Sly Stone. And, you know, my film definitely does exactly what you're describing. Like, you know, when you're talking about my movie, yeah, you're gonna learn a lot about the history of the band. But I think what really shines through with my film is that you experience what it's like to be in Sly's world and under Sly's cloud. I mean, I've had people, including band members who have seen the film, come up to me and be like, that third act, I've been there, buddy. I feel your pain. I know, you know, you're just in this place where like you're called to a place and you sit and you wait and then you go at a moment's notice and then, oh, he changes his mind and you sit and you wait and you deal with a lot of hiccups and characters and just, it's insane. It's insane. But I really felt that. And by proxy, I almost kind of felt like what it is to sort of be him. You know, we had that connection in a weird way. And I sort of needed to go through that to realize, you know, what kind of man he is and what being in his world is like. I mean, some of, you know, we were just listening to the music. Like, it gets me higher than pretty much any other music that I know. Yeah. Like, it's got the highs and the lows, and that's part of his genius.
So again, talking to Michael Rubenstone, the director, writer, producer, the father of just an amazing documentary. And I'm not saying this to blow smoke, man. I really mean it. I got it 2 days ago and I've watched it 3 times on the Sly in Search of the Family Stone.
It's very rewatchable. It's rewatchable. You know, you pick
it,
up.
It really is.
And, you know, it's always a ride.
We're talking about Sly Stone here. And for those who aren't as familiar as funk heads like myself and Michael, Sly Stone came up in the, you know, he had been in the business. He was born in Texas. His family moved to Vallejo, home of E-40. And then he got into that. He was a musical genius, right? He was a prodigy. I think he was playing keyboards by 7. He then played the drums, bass, guitar by 11. Right. So he was actually a musical prodigy, I think.
Yeah. I mean, you know, they were a church family and, you know, it was part of the deal was, you know, you grabbed an instrument and you just started playing with it and you started singing and you grabbed a tambourine and you started banging on it. Like that was in the, you know, their world and it continued. And Sly, I think he recorded his first album. It was a gospel album with his brothers and sisters, the Stewart Four, when he was maybe 7 or 8 years old, something like that.
He did. That's right.
Yeah.
He sang.
And so he was just steeped in music and it just grew from there.
Yeah, he joined a group with some buddies, and it was a multiracial group, which people now are probably thinking, why are you saying that? But look, in that day, it was a big deal. You didn't have multiracial groups. In fact, you didn't have multiracial genres, right? The genres themselves were you know, they were divided by race. It's just what it was. And don't take for granted what we have today because it wasn't like that then. And so Sly Stone created a group called the Viscanes, and they played for a bit, you know, played around. And then he started doing his own band. And then he also became a DJ at KSOL. And as a guy who grew up in the Bay Area, I'm very familiar with KSOL because when I was younger, they were the funk and the soul and the disco station, right? When it transformed into disco. But KSOL, man, I mean, that was a big deal. And he was a DJ and he was a popular one. And I think at that point he began to say, hey, I can do this shit.
Yeah. I think that was a really influential time. You know, he was not only the DJ at KSOL, which was an eclectic, you know, music station. You know, he was playing everything, R&B, soul, funk. I mean, whatever funk there was, James Brown. You know, he was playing the Rolling Stones, the psychedelic 60, you know, sort of invasion. So he was getting all this sort of data sort of in his cranium, you know, during this time. And he had just also studied music theory at a community college with Professor David Froelich, who introduced him to, you know, the basics of music theory and counterpoint. And then he's also at the same time, you know, joined up and was a producer at Autumn Records, which was a really small label, working with, you know, the Warlocks, you know,
Bob Rummels.
Before they became the Grateful Dead, he worked with the Bob Rummels. He worked with, you know, he had some singles out there. Mm-hmm. Freeman, Come On and Swim. You know, doing demos with Billy Preston, you know, young Billy Preston. So he was ready. He was ready to do his thing. And I believe it was Jerry Martini who became the saxophone player who, you know, just sort of said to him one day, just ran into him. It's like, you know, we should start a band.
Yeah.
I think that would be a good idea. And I think you should be the leader.
So I think, you can correct me if I'm wrong, Michael, but he created a band and his brother, Freddie, had also created a band. And one day in the kitchen, they decided, hey, why don't we put our bands together?
Yeah.
And that's when they came up.
So Freddie had a band called Freddie and the Stone Souls, and Sly had a band called Sly and the Stoners. And my band had Cynthia Robinson and John Turk, and then Freddie's band had drummer Greg Rico. And I think the word around the Stewart sort of household was that Freddie's band was just like a lot better. And Sly was DJing, you know, he was very busy, so he didn't have as much time to rehearse. And then one day, I think Sly sort of like was like, all right, maybe I should team up. And one day, I think Greg Rico came to the house and he was like, where's the Stone Souls? And he's like, well, we're starting a new band tonight. So Gary was there and Cynthia, who was Sly pulled from his band. And they went and got Larry Graham, who was playing with his mother, in like a duo around the Bay Area.
You know, I've always found that was really interesting. It's like, oh yeah, when they brought in this bassist named Larry, it's like, dude, he ended up becoming the inventor of slap bass. He's like one of the greatest bassists of all time, you know, in these genres, definitely pioneering. And it's like, oh yeah, we just found him, you know, at a church with his mom. Jesus.
Yeah, no, I think what happened was he was playing guitar in that band and they had a drummer and the drummer quit. So he started to, he just started to hit the guitar and just sort of hit it in such a way to make up for the lack of percussion. So he just kind of started to find a way to play the bass notes while he was, you know, also playing guitar because they lost their drummer. And that started it. And he just further grew that sort of concept and technique in Sly and the Family Stone.
Yeah, that's amazing. Just, oh yeah, get this guy named Larry. It turns out to be the greatest, one of the greatest, you know, funk bassists ever.
Yeah.
God bless you, Bootsy. I mean, that's a debate for another day.
Yeah, no, I mean, you had a monster band. You had Larry Graham who was innovating the bass. You had
Graham Central Station.
Yeah, he went on to do Graham Central Station.
Yeah.
I mean, you had, Greg Rico, who's probably the one of the most sampled drummers of all time, just in terms of, you know, rap sampling, you know, his drum beats. You had Freddie Stone, who's just one of my favorite guitarists. Like, I just love Freddie's. I mean, he's just so smooth and an incredible talent, an incredible voice.
Yeah.
Also, I mean, I've also been told that Freddie was really heavily involved in sort of the musical direction of the band.
Okay.
When Sly wasn't available or whatever, Freddie just was, he was the guy that everybody leaned on. And, you know, of course, Sly wrote the music and, you know, his arrangements for horns is just.
Oh, yeah.
When you have a female, you know, trumpet player. Cynthia just on the throne.
Can I tell you, like, who didn't have a crush on Cynthia? And you got to meet her, and even I don't know what age she was in your movie, but she was still a bad bitch. She was cool as she was so cool.
The coolest.
Yeah.
And also just a sweet, sweet lady. Just really, really genuinely just considerate, sweet, you know, just, I don't know. She'd like, you know, she'd cook you dinner if you needed some food.
Yeah. She was awesome. I remember watching her when he was in concert, right? And just the way, like when they did Dance to the Music and she would do that little scream, right? And it was just amazing, man. But the horns were awesome. Amazing.
And Jerry Martini, incredible. You know, they were just a power duo. And then Rose is just like, you know, who joined the band a little bit later. I mean, her vocals are just like, and then everybody is a star, just like, and Family Affair, like, she is a really unique talent, and you know, they were rock stars. They were just such.
Well, let's talk about that, because they really were, and they really, what he did. And by the way, their rise was so fast. So they put the band together, I think 66, 67, they started, right. That's when they started putting the band together with Freddie and with Sly. And they were already doing albums, right? They were discovered by actually one of the highlights of your movie, is David Kaepernick. That guy, he was the A&R guy for Epic. And who also was their agent, which I don't know what, I guess they have no conflict laws in our world.
Very rare for someone that works at a record company to also manage a band.
Yeah. Is that possible?
Yeah.
But David Kaepernick was the guy that was like, oh, these guys are geniuses. And he saw what Sly was doing, what Sly did. And again, if you're looking at this from a chair in 2022, you don't get it. You're like, big deal. Yeah, he had like white dudes and black dudes in the same band, in women and men. So what? You know, it was a huge deal then. People don't understand it. Back then, if you had a band, the women were in the back doing doo-wop, right? They were like, you know, they were saying, woo, right? That was their deal. And you either had a black group or you had a white group. That's just what it was. Sly, and it's so perfect because it was that time. It was the time, the seasons of love, right? The hippies were coming together for you. You know what I mean? It fit the moment. And he was there. He rode that zeitgeist. His genius rode that zeitgeist for those brief, let's call them 4 years, 5 years that he was at the top.
And I think that, yes, that is a remarkable thing. But what's even more remarkable to me is the fact that I don't think he really thought about it as something that, like, he wanted to do as a political statement, you know, or a representation of that moment, that zeitgeisty moment in the late 60s. I don't think he was even thinking like that. He was like, I just want to play with musicians. And if they're white, if they're black, if they're a girl, it didn't matter. You know, I maybe in the back of his head he did, but I think he just, you know, these are my people. And it was a small community, like, you know, so it made their rise like pretty astounding and was probably overwhelming. Well, it became overwhelming, you know.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
So fast and such. Sure.
So they were in the kitchen in 67 and they decide to throw their stew together, right?
Just playing local. He played at the Winchester Cathedral, which was owned by Rich Romanello, who was their first manager before Kaepernick, and played at the after hours spots. They became known as sort of a cult phenomenon because whenever the band sort of ended, all the other bands finished their gigs and they'd come to this late night spot and watch Sly. And they'd start at like midnight and play till 4 a.m.
Yeah, you're right. You're right. I remember that. I've read about that.
Small endeavor that just, you know, and then Kaepernick came in and
he caught some shows, right? He caught some of those late shows.
He came in and saw them once. And, you know, the story says that he and Sly went to an IHOP after the show.
That's right.
And said, "Let's do this. You know, I'll manage you. I think your band's going to be a monster."
And then they were already putting out, right? They put out the album, and I think in '68, and then '68 they had Dance to the Music, and then boom, that's when the roller coaster started going up.
Yeah, I mean, you know, and it wasn't. It seems like faster than there was a year where they were playing in Vegas, and played some kind of underground sort of gigs in New York City. There was like Warhol sort of underground clubs and stuff. And their first album was a bust.
It was, yeah. Something new, or what was that? Something brand new, or a whole new thing. That's right.
A whole new thing. And, you know, a lot of people in the industry, a lot of musicians, were really impressed by a lot of the arrangements and stuff, but in the end there wasn't a hit record, and Kaepernick said, you know, you need a hit single, man. You gotta figure out something to get some traction on the radio. And he's like, I'm gonna go back to San Francisco and I'm gonna write you a hit single. And it was Dance to the Music.
Yeah, right. Right. And I heard Clive Davis is on your. Was that, by the way? How'd you get Clive Davis? How did that go around? How hard was that?
Everything about this movie was hard. You know, it took me 12 years to make. It was a true labor of love. It was on a shoestring. Like, you know, I'm not backed by any studio. I'm an indie guy. I'm a punk rock filmmaker. And I just said, you know, I just put my mind to it. And I was just like, I'm just going to do this. And if I had thought twice about, you know, what I was going to go through or the costs involved and, you know, personally and financially, I would have never made this film. But because I didn't know shit and I just believed and I just went for it, I made a film and it's unreal. It's yeah. A crazy movie, you know, but it was that sort of raw determination. Like, I just have to tell this story. This story had to be told. This music is too good.
So back to 68. His first one was a bust. Then he put out Life. He put out the Dance to the Music album. I think Life was okay, right? The Life album was all right.
I love the Life album. I think it's great. But yes, it did not hit like.
It didn't have the hits. Right.
But, yeah. You know, they were definitely on the rise. And then they put out Stand.
That was all she wrote, man. When they put out Stand.
There's not a bad track.
Not one.
I'd say like 8 of the 10 tracks or whatever were like, you know, on the charts. I mean, it's incredible. I am everyday
people. Yeah, not one. Everyday people, Stand, you know, actually the best, I think one of the best cuts on that, we can't really say the name of it anymore, but God, that was an amazing song. Don't Call Me.
Don't call me.
Yeah, that was just an amazing song. Now, those of you who are interested in hearing a good piece of music from the height of the spirit, right, of the times, that's the song you got to listen to and remember when it was written and what was happening in this country.
Unbelievable, you know. Yeah.
And then in 69, right, he goes to the biggest the biggest concert, right? Yeah. With the biggest stars and the biggest audience. I mean, what were there, like 250,000 people at Woodstock?
Half a million?
Half a million people at Woodstock. The biggest stars at that moment were at Woodstock. I think all of them except Led Zeppelin, right?
Yeah, I mean, you know, I'm sure the Beatles had just broken up. I mean, the Rolling Stones weren't there. Look, it was an incredible collection of artists. And he
stole the show.
He really did. I mean, he just put on a show that, oh my God, I wish I was there for that.
So I've always told people, like, you know, hey, if you could be somebody for a moment, right? And you could relive that moment, go back in history and just be them for that moment, like, who would you be, right? And I would be Sly Stone. Singing Let Me Take You Higher in front of 500,000 people and owning every one of those for the, you know, however many minutes it took him to sing that song. Would be him, and I would gladly die right after that performance ended, because I know that I would have been at the highest a human can be. Now that I've watched your movie, I understand maybe I don't want to do that.
Well, you will never get that high again. I mean, it was the apex, you know.
It was. I, you know what, Michael, in my notes right next to it, I have apex. It was the apex.
It really was. I mean, that performance really made me a devotee. Like, I had never, ever seen a live performance like that in my life. And, oh, my God, you could just feel it. And I was watching the documentary, you know, like, and I could just feel it. It elevated. Yeah. He really took everybody higher. And it was like 3 in the morning.
Yeah, it was like 3 in the morning. right? And he had a call and response going with 500,000 people, and he owned them. They weren't doing it because they felt bad for the dude on stage. They felt it because he was commanding them to call and respond, man. And everything about it, the lighting, right? The purplish lighting, the fringe, the bodysuit, the glasses. Like, I wanted to be him in that moment. Again, gladly die right after that performance, because I feel that I would have reached the heights that a human could reach.
Right. Yeah. And it's interesting, Summer of Soul, Questlove, John, that just came out.
Same summer.
Yeah, it was right before Woodstock. So a lot of the sort of stuff that he was working through that, you know, eventually, was at Woodstock. He was sort of like prepping for that festival.
It's pretty amazing.
Yeah, and so shopping in the village, and that's how they got all those crazy costumes for Woodstock.
How did they get those costumes, man?
Yeah, they were just shopping in New York in the East Village, and they're just having fun and in a band. And they picked up that fringe thing.
They get Larry Graham's like Robin Hood hat?
Oh, dude, man, some of those outfits, unreal. Just, they look like, people that came down from space,
The suit he wore with the fringe and the bodysuit, it was just, God, it was perfect, man. And so every time I watch it, Michael, honestly, I tell you this, and my wife will back it up. I tear up. I tear up when I watch that performance. I don't tear up because it's sad, right? I tear up because I'm like, that is what music's about. Right there. That's what it's about. Why I tear up because I'm like, God, if we could have that again, if we could have that type of entertainment one more time, if we can have an audience like that, right? One more time. God. And I just feel like that moment is, we're never going to recapture that moment, but it just to see a master at his apex just makes me like so emotional.
I gotta say, what you just said, if we could all feel this, I honestly, when I started making this film, it was right after 9/11, I started to make this doc, and I was craving that feeling. I was craving that connectedness. And I really did believe that this music could make the world a better place. I know it sounds corny, but when you feel that, and when you see that performance, you understand, he was connecting everybody in that space. And that's what makes him a genius, and that's what makes music so powerful. And it was in late 69 with a community. Like, it was not just about the band or the music, it was everything. And I was needing that in my life. And Sly was a sort of conduit for me at that time.
So in making this movie, so I think we can all agree that that was the absolute apex of Sly Stone. And right, it came very quickly after the beginning of the group. In 1969, he stole Woodstock. He was doing the summer concerts in Harlem, and he put out the greatest album of his career in 1969. Right. And then he goes quiet.
Well, he did a greatest hits album right around that time too, which was one of his biggest sellers.
Had two number one, it had two big hits on it, right?
Yeah. I mean, well, it had his greatest hits, and then it had Everybody's a Star, and I think one other new single. But
hot fun and hot fun. Actually, Thank You for Letting Me Be Myself was on that.
That's right.
Yeah.
So, he was giving his fan base a little something. And then, I think shortly after that, the Woodstock film came out, and that really just pushed everything over the top, because, maybe people had heard about his performance, but when they saw it, it was, everybody was running out and buying albums and getting on the train. Mm-hmm.
And then he didn't make anything for a while.
Yeah, he gets a lot of flack for that, but even David Kaepernick said, I think 2 years is a short time to wait for another Sly Stone album. I think he had that written and put up in his office or something. that was his publicity sort of, headline. But, 2 years, honestly, though, these days, that's not that big a deal. I think really, you know, cranking them out in the, during that period.
Yeah, during that period, though, that was a long time because they used to crank them out, man.
Correct. That's true.
Yeah. So then he comes out with maybe people think is one of the seminal albums, right, of the 20th century, where there's a riot going on. And there's a great story behind that, you know, how he put that together. And what's your take on how he approached it and the darkness that we hear about? And is that true? Was he in a very, very dark period then? Or?
Oh, yeah.
I know he was growing apart from the rest of his band. It really was just the Sly Stone show at that point.
Yeah, I think that was the beginning of it. The band was still together at the time, but definitely starting to fracture. But that was when Sly moved to L.A. You know, he moved from San Francisco, which was his base. You know, his parents were there. He was very close with his parents. You know, the whole band was up there. So he sort of moved a lot of people down. But I think some people did not join, or they just, you know, would come down periodically to do, you know, sessions. But when that starts to happen, you know, and everything else that comes with Los Angeles and fame and, you know, hanging in Bel Air, you know, with celebrities like Bobby Womack and Ike Turner and, you know, like Red Fox, and just like Richard Pryor, it's going to get a little, you know, things are going to get a little funky, not in the funky way. Like it's going to get a little distracting, and music is not going to be your primary focus. You know, Sly, he loved music, you know, but he was having a good time. You know, I think there's a riot going on. It's just a reflection of the time. And it's a reflection of Sly. Sly was also like, you know, there was a lot of political sort of upheaval, and there was a lot of, you know, militant groups that were sort of saying, you know, you should get rid of that white manager, you should get rid of that white drummer. And just like, you know, it was a lot of, you know, he was pushed and pulled in a lot of different directions. And, you know, he was a sensitive cat and also really famous and, you know, probably didn't know which way to go, and he just went inward, and it all came out, and there's a riot going on, and it's very much a Sly album. You know, he was just there, and like I said before, he was, you know, he used that that Rhythm King, which was the first drum machine to be used in a track. You know, up till then, it was, you know, use your drummer, but he laid down that track because the drummer wasn't there, or it was 4 a.m. and he had a great idea. So he just pushed a button, started recording, and just played a bass line and started to build some things from there. And, oh, Bobby Womack's hanging out. He's like, Bobby, come play a lick, you know, or, you know, give me a little background vocals or whatever. And, oh, Ike Turner, you know, you're a good bass player, like lay down this bass. And, you know, and then every once in a while he'd bring in the band and, you know, to sort of flush things out. But he was recording, you know, in this, you know, secret studio and, you know, behind a wall. He was also running around in a mobile home where he made like the engineers that were on call just move all the recording equipment into the mobile home and to record as they were like driving around. I mean, it was insane. Yeah. And he also, you know, he was indulging in a lot of stuff. And from what I'm told, there's a lot of times when he was just writing and on a jag and up for days working on a track, and then he'd just erase it. He just, you know, by the end, he's like, you know, no, I want to do something else. And that, you know, so everything just got prolonged, and that album took a long time, but yeah. It was really incredible.
Like, I think he would like.
I wouldn't say it's the first album you should listen to if you're.
Yeah, no, it won't give you a flavor.
But it's if you are a fan, you recognize.
So do you think a lot of that, now that you've been involved in the whole Sly Stone chase, and you know, you've met a lot of the folks that knew him intimately, do you think a lot of that behavior was his personality, an inherent personality that just became more apparent as he aged and, you know, was left to his own devices because of the money? Or do you think that it was brought up by the drugs and people and bad influences?
You know, you'd really have to ask Sly. I can only speculate. to answer your question, I think it's a variety of things. I think that, you know, he was partying a lot. He was dealing with fame on a level that most people never deal with. He was in a politically charged time in our country's history that was intimidating and frightening and scary and confusing. And, you know, and he also represented something, and he sort of maybe, you know, looked at as a leader, as a real leader. And I think he was able to lead through his music, but I think as an individual, I don't think he ever was interested in that. I don't think that he wanted that mantle. I think he was a pretty, you know, off camera, a pretty quiet, sensitive cat that, you know, just wants to have some fun and write music. So I think it's a huge combination of all those things. And, chemical and substance abuse thrown into the mix is not going to make it easier. It's just going to make it more scary and, you know, create a stressful, paranoid environment where you don't want to deal with that stuff. You'd rather just lay it down and lay low. And I think probably started to lay low. And, Sly Stone's one of the biggest recluses in rock and roll history. You know, and I think around that time, he probably started, you know, pulling away slowly. Although he was still a famous act for many years after that. But
yeah, that was
the beginning of the withdrawal.
Yeah, I mean, he put out some albums, actually one of my favorite songs, If You Want Me to Stay, came out of one of those later albums. But it reminds me of Prince's later output. When he was just dropping stuff indiscriminately, right? The quality kind of went down. But anyway, he put out some albums, dropped by his label, then he kind of disappeared. I mean, he had definitely disappeared from the performing and the concert scene, right? He was gone. And this is where, you know, your movie comes in, because you're like me. Are like, where did this guy go? Because he was like Prince. If you look at Prince, you look at the way Prince presented himself, his stage mannerisms, the way he dressed with the hat, with the jumpsuits, right? With all that was Sly, man. That was Sly. And I try to tell people, and they don't get it because they don't know who the hell he is, because there's nothing about him. I feel like his historical impact was great, but his footprint is like that of a baby. And so I think you probably feel the way I feel.
Absolutely. I mean, you know, Neil Young said, you know, it's better to burn out than to fade away. He's still fading, you know, since, you know, 71, 73. You know, this is a long time. It's almost 50 years.
Of a fade.
And, you know, there were people that like Jim Morrison, Janis Joplin, Jimi Hendrix, some of these legends that died really young became legends because of their death. But Sly just kind of hung in there and hung around and, you know, would make some appearances and try to make some comebacks. I mean, he tried to make some comebacks. And there's a few albums where he's like, there's even one album called Heard You Miss Me While I'm Back.
Yeah, right. It's all the instruments. And
So he tried, but, it wasn't the 60s anymore. The music was changing and Sly, you know, was not catching the ears of the public like he was.
So one of the best stories in your movie on the Sly in Search of the Family Stone. We're here with Michael Rubenstone, who put that whole thing together, is the Paul Schaefer bit.
Came out one time to play with me and my band on the Letterman show in the early 80s. I think he may have seen the show. And he was absolutely fantastic. It was like a dream come true. And I was so impressed that I called him at his hotel the next day and said, I just want to say what a great thrill it was to play with you and how terrific you were. And he said, thanks, you think I could borrow $100? And I said, well, sure. You know, I was sort of taken aback by it. You know, he came over. Gave him $100. He says, cool, you know, nice to see you. And when he left, I said to myself, damn, you know, I'll never, Sly has conned me out of $100.
Yeah, I mean, I think that, you know, that says a lot about where Sly was at the time. I think at that time he, you know, in the interview, he seems kind of like, I don't know, just a little desperate, you know, like almost a cry for help. I know he was playing with a band called the One-Eyed Jacks, which was a group in Chicago. He was playing with them at the time. And he's like, he sort of says in the interview, he's like, we're playing, like we want to work, like book us for some gigs. You know, he's kind of like reaching out to the music industry. Like I can still play. Like, but yeah, borrowing $100 is pretty telling too. But at the same time, there is something that I didn't put in the film, and Paul Schaefer has always given me shit for it because I didn't put, it's like, Michael, you need to put in the tag. Years later, Bobby Womack is playing the Letterman show, and he comes over to Schaefer, pulls out $100 and says, hey, Sly told me to give you this.
Oh my God. Of course, it probably was not Sly's money. He's probably saying, can you pay?
I have no idea. I don't even know if it's true. But Paul says it happened. I trust Paul. I'm going to go with the myth, even if it's.
Yeah. That's a great story, man. That tag is good. That tag was not in the movie.
I know. I should put it in the credits.
Yeah, like after the credits, right? That's that like hidden, that Easter egg there.
Exactly. Yeah.
So, the group was elected to the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame in 93. And I think you have some of that in your movie too. That was such a weird, weird deal, the way he came up. And then he started looking kind of odd at that time too. Is there a reason he began to look so different? I mean, everybody ages, but look at his brother, Freddie. Freddie looks like he just walked, right? I mean, Freddie looks like he's in the high school band. Bobby Womack still, you know, looked decent, right? In your movie, Cynthia looked great. But he looks really different. It's almost like a portrait of Dorian Gray, if you don't mind me saying that. No, but what happened?
I just know from my research, but look, he was struggling at that time. He was I know that he had some run-ins with the law. Mm-hmm. Spent some time in jail. There's larceny, something on his record. I think he was not paying alimony. So he was clearly in financial dire straits. I think around that time, he also sold his publishing to Michael Jackson. A song, you know, pennies on the dollar. Because he was so desperate.
I didn't know that. I never knew that.
Yeah. I think that was actually Michael Jackson's first like acquisition in terms of buying artists' catalogs.
Oh man.
Huge fan of Sly's. I think it was desperate times. This was not fun. Not fun. Just hanging on by the skin he's in. I believe he got in an accident, like he was injured at some point. So he also had some, you know, physical sort of health issues that he was dealing with. I mean, it was not, I can't imagine it was a fun time to be with Sly Stone. And but the thing is, man, during that time, he still had it. Like I've heard just like random stuff, random recordings and just, you know.
So,
little appearances he's made, man, he could still sing, like he could still do it. He just couldn't do it, you know. Mm-hmm. Being in the music industry and being a performer takes a lot of work and a lot of determination. He just probably didn't have it at that time.
Well, I don't want to give too much of your movie away, right? I want to leave some there for people to, you know, people to watch.
Yeah, whatever. Yeah. My film is still not available, so I'm sure it will be in due time. But
It should be. Honestly, it's awesome. It is. I've watched it. I don't repeat watch stuff. I don't. Like my wife always likes watching fucking Pineapple Express, right? And Bridesmaids. And I'm like, dude, how many times can you watch that? Right? But I watched your thing 3 times in 2 days because it is that good of a movie. And it has an arc, right? It has a dramatic, a narrative arc.
Oh, yeah.
It's great. You need to get that out there, Michael.
I know.
I'm not saying that as a fan because I have watched other documentaries like Unsung or something and, you know, whatever.
It's kind of a doc, you know, like it's a different kind of doc. Like it's a real immersive, you know, sort of punk rock, like verite experience. And you're just on it with me. It's a ride.
Well, you met some really interesting people. Yeah. So the one that got me are the guys that you met in the parking lot. Because I've met these kind of people before, because I put on huge parties and I hire rappers and hip hop guys, and I know these people. Like when you were talking to the guy in the parking lot who's like, yeah, just 5,000, and he can't do it today, but we can do it tomorrow, and you got to meet him here, and oh, he overslept, and you know, that kind of stuff. Believe me, I've heard all those stories. Mm-hmm. How did you feel like delving into that world? And the other thing, honestly, I wanted to say is it was very, very sad to see that in like 1972, 73, Sly Stone was hanging out with Muhammad Ali and Richard Pryor and Billy Preston. And now he's hanging out with the shadiest of shady dudes in parking lots trying to scam money off of a documentary film producer. So, I mean, how was that?
It was scary, man. Yeah, like it was... What this film does is it really does put you in Sly's world. You know, if you want to experience what it's like to be in Sly's, you know, circle, you know, the cloud that he dwells under, you want that experience. Like my film definitely does that. And I was right there. And it was weird. It was scary. It was exciting. It was wild. It was, you know, it was truth. It was desperation. I was just like connected with Sly in this way. He was communicating to me about where he was at without even saying a word. And that's the genius, you know. Everybody asked me, like, cause I don't meet and interview Sly in this film. And you know what? I'm glad that I didn't, because I got it. I got it in spades. You know, what he's about and what his genius is and what his flaws are and what his beauty is and what his, you know, just disgusting, just dirty side. I mean, he is Sly, you know, he's a hustler. He is a hustler. And, you know, like, I don't deal with that very often in my everyday. if it's a good day. So for me, it was kind of a thrill, you know, as sad and as depressing as it was sometimes, you know, I almost recognized, like, gosh, sort of feel bad for the guy. You know, I'm lucky to be making this movie and, like, you know, healthy and happy and I have a girlfriend at home or whatever, you know, like it sort of brought everything down to like real.
I think we touched on this at the beginning when I was saying that, you know, I had never met as big a Sly Stone fan as myself. And I thanked you for going through all the pain of actually chasing him and trying to meet him, because that was an endeavor that I actually wanted to do myself. But honestly, I think you learned everything you needed to learn about him just by the chase. It told you everything. And if you watch the movie, which hopefully everybody will get an opportunity, because it is amazing. And I'm not saying this because I'm a fan of Sly Stone. It just is a great documentary. It has this great narrative arc. Like, you don't have to be a bodybuilder to love pumping iron, right? It's just the narrative arc and the characters. And that's what your movie is awesome about. That's what's so awesome about your movie, rather. But the at the end, right? At the end, when there's, you know, there's a conclusion, let's call it that. There's a conclusion to the movie at the end. Was he what you thought he was when you looked at him?
Totally. I mean, are you talking about the convention? And
Brooklyn? At the very end.
Like, look, he got paid well, you know, he got flown out. He got paid well. He got a limousine. He had to show up for 10 minutes and then he left.
I mean, like, he didn't even talk. He just like waved his finger.
He does.
He did.
He does. I can show you the whole. But look, that was a great day, and I'm really, really happy that I was there that day because he looks good. Like he looked good. He looked happy. The band was all there. As many, that was one of the, you know, biggest collection of the band sort of getting together.
Was Larry there?
Larry was not there.
Okay.
But, you know, I think it could have been one of the last times, you know, he spent some time with Cynthia before she passed. Greg was there. Jerry was there. Freddie was there. You know, fans like me, you know, there's these twins and Holland that put this together with a couple other guys from Jersey. And they're biggest fans of me, bigger even. And it was a real celebration of music. Sly answered some questions. And, you know, it was just further sort of like, I didn't need an interview. Like, there's nothing that Sly Stone is going to tell me that is going to be like, oh, that's the answer. You know, it's right. Like, no, you know, it's all there. It's all in the music. It was all in my dealings with him and my experience and the people that I met. Like, man, I'm so grateful for.
Well, Kaepernick was amazing.
Oh man, that guy kind of changed my life. You know, after I went to Hawaii, you know, I was like, I want to die here. Like, right idea. I want to die in Maui. That's a good call. Good call on you, David. I love it. But yeah, no, him, I talked to Dick Cavett, you know, just one of the biggest legends in television.
Yeah.
Cornel West, like, gave me a history lecture that I will never forget and was better than anything I ever experienced in college as far as just, like, just, you know, the history of civil rights during that period and what Sly represented during that time. You know, Freddie Stone, I mean, I still talk to some of the band members. They did take me in. You know, I know Sly probably had his issues with me, but they completely embraced me. And, you know, I really think fondly of all of them. They're all really good people.
Can I ask you a question about, it's a particular scene in the movie, and I hate to do this when people might not have seen it, but it's something that I've always wondered since I watched your movie. In the very beginning of the movie, you go to a home where I think you believe he is, right? And it has a big S on the gate, and a Mexican kid comes to there and goes, no, you know, he doesn't live here. You're like, well, what's the S on the gate for? It's like, oh, that's just, you know, like a family name or something like that. And then you do an event, right, for the Funk Family Affair, and he shows up, right, because those are, you know, Cynthia and all those folks and Rose. And in the balcony was Sly, who, by the way, kept his motorcycle helmet on the entire time, which I thought was a little interesting. that's Sly, right? That Mexican kid was with him. Was that his house?
Absolutely.
Okay. All right.
I could have met him my first day of filming. And that's the ironic thing about this whole thing. You know, if I had just, you know, asked the right question or the right way, or when that door opened, just walked down and pushed the doorbell, like,
yeah,
I would have not, you know, the film could have been over in a day. I just hung with him that day. But no, that guy gave me the brush off. And I was so naive. Like, I could have asked, like, oh, what's your last name? And just seeing what his response is.
Oh my God. I screamed that at the screen. I was like, ask him his last name.
Could have. But I was a green filmmaker on my first day.
That is so amazing.
I just didn't have the wherewithal. Like I just took him at his word. But
you actually found him on your first day.
So
before we leave, and I want to thank you so much for doing this, man, because this is an amazing documentary. Again, I hope it gets out there soon because it is just a great story. By the way, what I find interesting, you look so different in so many different parts of the movie. Like one time you look like you're doing Guys and Dolls, right? And like, another time you look like Fredo. I'm like, what is this dude doing? Why does he always look so different, man?
I was actually like, I remember the first big shoot we had in the Bay Area meeting the band. I was actually shooting a film as an actor where I was playing a porn star. And I had this ridiculous
the mustache?
Caterpillar mustache.
Yes.
So when I met, you know, the Family Stone for the first time, I looked like, you know, I just looked like a sleazy 70s porn star.
You did. Well, I went with the guys and dolls. So afterwards, you know, we've learned more about him and we hear that he's living in a van on a beach, right, down in Crenshaw. Is this true? Is he still living out in a van kind of and just getting by people bringing him food?
I'm told right now, like, I know his manager pretty well and who takes care of him. I think he's doing good. Like, I honestly have heard good things lately. I don't keep up with it as much as I used to. But, yeah, there was a period, and definitely when I finished filming, like, he was living in a mobile home and just at a friend's house and getting power from, you know, his friend's house. And, you know, I think he lived in some hotels. He's sly. He does like to stay mobile. You know, he's one saying, like, I don't know when I'm going to need to piece out of here. Like, I want to be mobile.
Yeah, who knows coming after him? No, so,
but I have heard of late that he's done really well.
Okay, well, that's good to hear because he is still an idol of mine.
I really, you know, and look, I'm thrilled that he's still with us. Like, I can't believe it, and I'm just so, you know, it's important to celebrate these legends while they're still with us.
I was talking to somebody about the story, right? And I told them, you know, about, you know, him living on the beach and, or wherever he was living in a van. And I'm like, you know, we don't know that if Janis Joplin or Jim Morrison or Jimi Hendrix would have not died and they would have, like, right? Because the times changed. Music genres changed, right? We don't know. They wouldn't have ended up in the same place. Absolutely. Sly just didn't die, man. Stayed around.
He's a survivor, man. He really is. And those guys went out, you know, but do you think Janis Joplin and Jim Morrison would still be writing Light My Fire? And
no,
they would not.
They'd be meeting you in a parking lot.
That's possible. Or hopefully they, you know, go through their tough times and come through and have a career like, you know, like, David Crosby or Joni Mitchell. Sure. You know, there's a lot of people that went through the ringer with rock and roll and fame, came out the other side and found a way to still make music. But it gets harder, you know, and times change. And, you know, I know there's some sly music out there. I know it. I know that there's some hidden gems probably locked in, you know, the mobile home or safe deposit box or at some pawn shop, you know, in LA, just like some gem recordings that he did floating around. So hopefully that will resurface at some point.
Well, I hope that what you're doing and then what I'm doing by doing this and by talking to people, I hope what we're doing is helping people understand that one of the true, true pioneers of music, honestly. He was an absolute pioneer, an amazing influence on people like Stevie Wonder, on Prince, generations of musicians. He was an amazing influence on. I hope that we keep his name alive, right? And then we let people know. And then maybe someday, right, he will get the appreciation that he so rightfully deserves, whether he appears or not, right, to take that appreciation. But maybe the industry will appreciate him.
Yeah, no, I hope so. I think that time will tell. You know, he's got a great track called Time, and time needs another minute at least.
Okay. So thank you, Michael. I want to, whenever
your movie's out there. You guys can follow me, reach out to me. I'm at onthesly.movie.com. I'm on Instagram, onthesly.movie. Feel free to reach out to me if you're interested in checking out the flick. And I'll keep you posted on any screenings that come up and, you know, and hopefully, you know, some distributor will, you know, get there, you know, get with it and pull the trigger on this thing.
Yeah, totally. And I mean, honestly, it reminds me of Pumping Iron, where someone could have said, that's just a building about bodybuilders. Well, no, dude, it's actually a good story. It's an amazing story with great characters.
Right. It's Heart of Darkness. It's Moby Dick.
Right. It really is.
My stuff. You know, it's a fan, you know, you can make it if you try. It's got a great, great edict, you know, that I think is running through the film. It's just like, if you want to do something, if you believe in it enough, whether you're writing music, making a film, writing a book, you know, anything artistic or business, even whatever, if you push, you're persistent, you can not meet Sly Stone.
Yeah, right. Michael Rubenstone, thank you so much. Good luck with your acting and your voiceovers. And let's get this movie out there. All right, man, thank you. Hey, if you like what you hear, like and subscribe. It really means a lot, and we would love to have you coming back every week. Thank you. A pocket for fun, ha, ha, when you know that you're never number two. Number one, gonna be number one. And I'll be good, I wish I could.